So good evening, everyone. My name is Anurag, and I'm a senior director at Crow Harbor UAE for indirect tax and automation. Today, we're going to talk about some of the key concepts about VAT. Predominantly, what is the VAT is all about, that Nirav has already explained. But what is really, so how the VAT basically works, and what is the model of VAT working, and what really determines the taxability aspect for a business to really understand. So today, we're going to talk about the time of supply, place of supply, deemed supply, and some transition provision. Now, when the VAT, we talk about VAT, two key aspects are there basically. One is time and place. These two factors determine the taxability of a particular transaction. We always talk about that the VAT is very, very transactional. And the tax aspect, where it is going to be taxed, what time it is going to be taxed, will be determined based on these two concepts. So let's begin with the place of supply. What is the place of supply is all about? The VAT will be due where a taxable supply is made by a taxable person. Now, what is a taxable person? A taxable person is a person who provides the taxable goods above a particular threshold. So if a person turnover is above 375,000, or voluntarily he's registering his turnover is 187,500, he becomes in the category of the taxable supply. So he becomes a taxable person. And anything which is not exempt is basically a taxable product. So if he deals into any of the product or service which is not exempt, he'll consider it to be a taxable supply. So that's where the VAT becomes due. A supply of goods and services in UAE by a person for a consideration. So the consideration aspect, Nirav has already explained that it's not necessarily to be in form of money. It can be barter transactions, it can be exchange of services, and in the course of conducting a business. So if I'm doing an activity on ad hoc basis, now that is not considered to be, that is a transaction that is done for a course of business, that's ad hoc transactions are not considered to be conducting business itself. And when the VAT is also applied, also includes an importation of goods by a person and a deemed supply. I will touch base on a deemed supply, what is it all about, in my further slides. Now, what are the taxable supplies are? So the definition is very, very clear. The tax is due on the goods. And what is the good basically? The passing of ownership of the physical property rights, physical property to the transferee, or passing on the right to use that particular property to the owner is by another person is basically a good. And with respect to service, anything which is not goods is service. So eventually, like, you know, they try to cover every single aspect of things. There is no much of the things left. Consideration. Consideration is anything that is received in return of the supply. If consideration is only money, the value of that supply is amount of money received. So basically, whatever we receive in term of, like, you know, whether it's a discounted price, so whatever the value that we receive against a particular supply is considered to be taxable value. And consideration is treated as VAT inclusive. In case the VAT is not charged, then the value is considered to be inclusive of VAT. The place of supply rule determines where the supply is made for the VAT purposes. Where the supply is made within the UAE, the UAE VAT is going to apply. Now, there are separate provisions which are available in relation to different supplies and different services, such as, for example, fixed assets, such as installation of services, telecommunication, online transactions, where the place of supply slightly vary. We're going to cover those in subsequent slides. So what is the place of supply? As per the law, where the supplier has a place of residence. So basically, if I'm operating a business within the UAE, that's considered to be my, and I'm having a fixed establishment here, so that is considered to be my place of supply. And if I'm having a threshold turnover criteria fulfilled, then my place of residence will consider to be a place of supply. In case I'm doing a supply within the GCC itself, then there's an exception to the place of supply rule. In that case, the customer's place of residence is considered to be place of supply. Now, what's the difference between the two? In the first place, since the supply is happening here within the UAE itself, so my UAE VAT standard rate or zero rate can apply. But since in second case, the supply happening within the GCC member state, now it considered to be a different tax rate. That's there. Place of supply of service supplied by a person that is not resident in UAE. So if let's say service is provided by somebody outside the UAE and outside the GCC basically, that is a separate provision itself. In that case, the place of supply is considered to be UAE because other person is not registered. Place of supply of the service relating to installation of goods where the service is being performed. So in case of services, the place of supply is basically where the service is being performed. And place of supply of restaurant, hotel, catering services where they are performed basically. Some of the examples, so I'll try to go like, you know, more practical aspect of things and try to address the scenarios out there. So in case of real estate related services, if supplied, these services are considered to be placed where the real estate is located. So if I'm doing any services, any construction that I'm doing within the GCC, if I'm doing anything outside GCC, although my company is registered, then the place of supply is considered to be the place where the property is situated. Such as like provision of hotel accommodation, service of real estate agent and real estate experts, service related to construction work, architect service relating to a specific plot of land. So any service that you provide in relation to that, though your company is established here, but if you're providing any service in relation to a property which is located outside, the place of supply will gonna be outside. And then the provision according to that will gonna apply in this case. Another example is there, cross-border B2B supply. So let's say consider a situation where a UK company is there. And a UK company is providing a legal service to a UAE company. Now in this case, what will gonna happen? UK company is not registered in UAE. And UAE company is a registered business in here. So when you provide service, basically UK company cannot charge a tax on behalf of this business. So UAE company will have to account for the tax following the reverse charge mechanism. Now what is the reverse charge? I will explain in a second slide. But if you see the principle here, if a person who is not resident and providing a service to a registered business in UAE, then the place of supply is a UAE. And that's why the UAE tax is going to apply here. Second transaction again we see here, the cross-border B2B supply for a real estate service. Now this service is provided by a person outside UAE to a person outside UAE but for a property in UAE. So if you see in this situation here, the UK company is providing service to a KSA company for a property within the UAE. Now in that case, the 5% VAT is going to apply and the UK company has to have a place of establishment, a business registered within the UAE. Because place of supply is UAE, the property is situated here. Another transactions, the lease of UAE real estate by a non-UAE landlord. So let's say I having a commercial property itself in UAE. Now what will happen in that situation? In that situation again, the UK person or let's say individual, it's a maybe a registered company or individual person, lent out there and he provides the service again in that so fixed establishment. The UK company has to register in UAE here again. Very, very interesting topic that everybody is going to have some understanding about the free zones. So let me just give you a little bit my understanding how I interpret the law. In the free zones, not the entire free zone going to be designated, exempt. Now if you see the registration process, we are going for a lot of registration at the moment. And while we're registering the business, if some of you have tried the registration process, you will find that all the free zone entities, all the free zone authorities are there part of the registration process. So if you have a business today in free zone, you have to disclose that. Whether you have in Zabja, you have DMCC or TCOM, wherever you have business, you have to disclose that. So it means that there has some sort of like, you know, consideration in relation to the free zones as well. And in the law, there's a concept about designated zones. And some of you who have read excise law a little bit, they'll understand that to define a designated zone, individual person need to apply to the free zone authorities to consider a particular zone to be a designated zone. So it means that if I interpret that, the entire free zone not gonna be a designated zone. So within a free zone, there'll be certain area which will be fence and which will, where the goods movement is pretty much tracked, will be considered as a designated zone. And for that, application has to be made and there's certain conditions which need to be fulfilled to be considered a designated zone. But for the sake of explanation, I'll take an example here. So let's say a company which is established in a designated zone, in free zone, providing a service to registered mainland company. What happened to that situation? So if a designated zone free zone company providing a service to the mainland entity, that is considered to be import of service by a registered UAE business. And a place of supply will be considered as UAE. And since a designated company, the free zone company is in designated zone, that is considered to be outside. So again, in this case, reverse Shazil gonna apply. Second scenario, free zone company providing service to the mainland company. Now this is a scenario where if the free zone company is in outside designated zone. So if it is outside designated zone, then it is considered to be a establishment in UAE and it will gonna charge straight away 5% VAT. Although executive regulation should really certify what I'm saying is right, but that's what the interpretation that I do have. The place of supply UAE and the supplier will account for the UAE VAT. This is again a scenario which a lot of business has here because you know a lot of trading businesses are here. So we do a lot of trade oriented business here. What happens, I'm a textile trader and I do a lot of imports from India and I sell it to China, I'll send it to Russia or I'll send it to UK straight away. Through, I'm a distributor here, so I do the placement B2B supply outside the UAE itself, but invoice is routed from here. Now what that considered the transactions? Will it gonna be taxable transactions or it will not gonna be taxable transactions here? Now that's a lot of people think about. So in this case, let's understand and establish where exactly the movement of goods happening. And let's go back to the again, where the supply of goods is happening in this case. So in this case, if you see situation here, from India directly to Russia, so goods is moving outside the UAE territory. And what is moving within the UAE territory is basically the invoice document. So invoice from Indian manufacturer to UAE and from UAE distributor to Russia customer. So it's a physical, only the movement of goods that's happening, but actual movement of the goods is outside the UAE. And therefore, the place of supply is outside UAE and it's outside the UAE, VAT perspective. Export of goods outside GCC. We all do hear a lot of trade, especially if you can, I'll talk about textile market. So, lot of trade happens, direct and indirect trades are there. So basically, when we re-export, when we import goods and re-export, following the normal procedure, pretty straightforward, it's export of business, I'm gonna consider zero rate supply. But what if a customer comes in here and buy the goods, and then he himself exports? Will it be considered as an export? Will zero ration gonna apply to that? A lot of us has a, you know, question on that. So what is a direct export? Let us understand about direct export. The direct export, the supplier is responsible for arranging the transport. So when I gonna do an export, it's my responsibility to arrange the transport and I arrange all the customs clearance and things like that. And goods are physically exported outside GCC or put into the custom suspension regime within 3 months of date of supply. So basically I have a time bound duration here. Within 3 months, I need to be put to the custom and clearance altogether if I define it to be an export. The official and commercial evidence of the export is retained by exporter. So there has to be bill of lading and there has to be proof of export that need to be kept if you define a particular export to be supplied to be an export and considered to be zero rated. Indirect export. Now indirect export is something that an overseas customer, when an overseas customer deal with supplier within the UAE and he arrange for the logistic of the goods. So it's overseas customers who are arranging the logistics of goods from a supplier within the UAE, that is considered to be indirect export. And he can do it himself or by an agent. The goods are physically exported, again same condition, goods are physically exported outside GCC or put to in customs suspension within 3 months of supply. Either the first condition is there or official and commercial evidence of export is provided by overseas customer retained by the exporter. So now, if you see the second scenario, as an Indian expat, I come to UAE and I buy a lot of goods here. I mean, considering a lot of laptops, electronics, music systems, and so on and so forth, I keep on buying a lot of things out there. And I put together, I arrange the entire export for it to India following any means of that cargo and various things out there. It's prerogative of the supplier. He should charge me VAT. Unless I provide him the proof that I'm exporting this entire goods outside the GCC itself. If I'm providing that proof, he can do the zero ration. But it doesn't mean that, you know, immediately when you're selling itself, you're going to do zero rate. You're going to charge standard way. But if he provide you the proof, you can claim a refund against it. Now, export does not mean that the goods do not leave the state of possession of a passenger or crew member of an aircraft or ship. So, indirect export doesn't mean that, you know, you come in UAE with a family of 6 people or 8 people and you carry 8 laptops and that considered to be an export. Or you consider things like that. It has to be an export proof itself via custom. So in this case, again, the supply can be zero rated. You can do the zero ration about it. Reverse charge. What is basically reverse charge is, let me put together in very simplistic form. If you talk about VAT, who is liable to collect the VAT? I believe it's supplier. So it's a supplier's responsibility to collect the VAT and comply with the VAT. But if the supplier is not registered and supply is happening UAE, what should ideally happen in your opinion? The VAT has to be collected. The government needs the VAT. But supplier is not registered and place of supply is in UAE, then the owner shift, because there's 2 parties to the transaction, so obviously the owner shift to the second party itself is the customer. So the government asks customer that if the supplier is not registered, it's your prerogative to account for the VAT liability in your books. But they don't ask for the payment right away on that spot. This is, you account for the liability, but the moment you use that service for providing a taxable supply, you collect the VAT and pay me the VAT on that side of things. So that's a simplistic understanding of the reverse charge mechanism here. So again, applies when a VAT registered person imports into UAE, the service from supplier established outside the country, and those services would be subject to VAT if purchased in UAE. So I'm talking about those supply which is taxable. I'm not talking about supplies which is exempt. Recipient of account for the VAT due on the supply in his VAT return. So he'll gonna make an entry. So let me just give you an understanding on the entry. So when you purchase something itself, you say purchase debit to supplier. If you buy locally, you'll say purchase debit, input VAT debit to supplier. And that becomes your liability. But in case of reverse charge, what happens? In case of reverse charge, it happens that you're gonna say purchase debit, input VAT debit, which is I'm supposed to pay, to my supplier, to output VAT. Payable, output VAT. Now in this case, supplier gets actually the due amount what he's supposed to do. And I'm also not paying the VAT because it's a contra entry. So ultimately the cash flow impact is slightly null, but it has impact in my books. The VAT liability and asset recorded. Next time I'm gonna sell it, I'm gonna use that VAT into it. So this example is slightly easier. Supplier is outside, he's gonna raise me invoice with zero rate VAT. And he's a customer in UAE, so he's recipient place of establishment in UAE, he'll gonna account for the reverse charge. A slight example of that, the inbound real estate service supplied by B2B, which I explained before. So the UK company, again providing supply to a UAE company. And now if you see here, 5 AED is an output and 5 AED is input. This I'm supposed to pay to FTA when I'm making the supply using this particular service. I collect and pay. What is defined as import? What is really import? So where the goods are destined. The place of import is basically where the goods are destined to. So if I'm getting a good itself that is to be destined, final destination to be KSA, then the KSA is the destination for the import. Are goods placed in one of the specific customs arrangement upon entry into the country? Yes. If the goods are just moving without the custom clearance, those are not considered to be imported goods. It has to be through custom. When is the VAT chargeable? When is the VAT chargeable on the custom? Depending on the first place where the goods are destined. What is the taxable amount of imported goods for the VAT purposes that Nirav has enlightened already to us altogether? So import of goods undertaken by any person, whether the person is taxable or not, subject to VAT. It's subject to VAT. under reverse charge. Let's talk about time of supply. When the tax, what is my taxability point? When I'm really supposed to collect the tax, you know, what is the taxable? So is it when I render a service? Is it something when I raise an invoice or I receive a payment or I deliver goods or, you know, the goods in transit? What is really, you know, my time of supply itself? So let's understand that basic tax point for the goods is basically date of removal of the goods in case of supply of goods with the transportation. So if I'm doing a CIF delivery, the moment the goods leaves my warehouse, that becomes my taxable point. Whether it reached to the recipient or not, the moment the goods leave my warehouse, that becomes a taxing point. But in case, the date on which goods made available, in case I'm not providing, I'm providing FOB prices itself, and I'm not arranging the transport, and it's a customer's prerogative to arrange the transport. In that case, when the goods finally reach the customer, that becomes my taxing point. So he gives me acceptance. Date of assembly, installation, supply of goods involving assembly and installation. So when the date of installation assembly occurs, that's become my tax point. And basic tax point services, when the date on which performance of service is complete. So if I initiate a service, that's not my tax point. When I complete a particular service, that becomes my tax point. And a tax point is where you record your tax liability. It's not invoice, it's not payment, it's not delivery. Tax point is something when you record your liability. So this is an example. The VAT shall be chargeable at the date supply is made, goods delivered or service performed, or person making the supply issues an invoice in relation to the supply or received the full or partial payment in respect of that particular supply. And if you see right side here, whichever falls earlier. Now, whichever falls earlier, why it is so? Because various supplies having various payment terms. So you made a supply and the payment is not received. The payment is not made from your side, the tax liability that is due. But at the same time, other person will gonna take input VAT credit. So government did not receive the money, whereas before somebody has already taken the input VAT credit. So it will be deficit issues. So that's why the moment you make either of the transaction, whether you supply goods, whether you raise an invoice, or you receive full or partial payment, that becomes my taxing point, whichever falls earlier. So this is an example here. If you say placement of order, partial payment received, goods delivered, invoices issued, full amount of received. Now, the moment partial amount received, I'm going to account for the VAT at that stage. So a lot of businesses at the moment, we receive advance. We receive advance against the purchase orders. And most of times, there is no physical document moves in here. It's written on the purchase order and saying that 20% advance, we start receiving it. But going forward in VAT regime, what you will not be able to do that. You have to raise a pro forma invoice, which will have an advance amount, and you need to provide the specific tax below that. So you say if the advance amount is 10,000, you're going to put 500 as a you know, the VAT on that. Should you not do so, the other person has all the means and right to say that, you know, 10,000 is the inclusive value of the VAT. That's what Dhirubhai explained altogether. Date of supply, when to account for output VAT on the supplies. So receipt of payment or the date of VAT invoice, if earlier than basic tax point. So this is overriding, that's what I was trying to explain. So receipt of payment or date of invoice is earlier than the basic tax point. This is slightly important aspect here, the continuous supply and a stage payment. So we various payments, we do a lot of continuous nature is there. You know, for example, if we go to a health club, it's continuous service for throughout the year. If I'm having a membership for various forums and various platforms, that's a continuous service. I'm having, you know, my subscription for some of the channels and things like that, continuous services there. So the earlier of receipt of payment, due date of the payment shown on the VAT invoice, or the date of the VAT invoice, for example, payment, whichever falls earlier, that becomes my taxing point. So the moment you receive the full amount, That's where the tax amount becomes due, whether the service will last for long 12 months. But if I receive the service, that becomes my tax point. So this is an example a little bit here again. So building material delivered to the customer on 1st March 2018, with the invoice issued on 1st April. So the tax point becomes the moment I supply the material itself. In second case, the payment received from the customer on 1st March, service started 1st April, service completed on 1st May. So this is again exception to the basic tax point. The payment is received already, that becomes my taxing point. The first payment of the construction work received on 1st February 2018. You see here, that becomes a my taxing point. So I raise invoice, I collect the VAT at that stage, I create the liability. Second payment again, the second payment of construction works received here again, invoice issued for first and second payment. So I'm receiving payment or I'm issuing the progress invoice which is against the advance. So what is the second point differential here? I'll be raising, I'll be creating the tax liability at that stage. Example four, the first part of construction is complete here. The construction is completed. The time of supply, construction completed and payment made here. That's when the tax. Under the transition rule, if you see here, 2017 and 2018. So in the transition rule, the due on the value related to the customer work completed after implementation of VAT, so then it will become the VAT due. Now, before I get into the next slide on that, let me just understand, and your understanding, I just need answers, some of your answers. How do you see the VAT enablement process? I mean, how do you prepare yourself for the VAT a little bit? What your understanding? So you're understanding the place of supply, time of supply. How does it make sense to you? What are you going to apply in your business? How this is going to, transform into your business processes? How do you really see? Anybody has started the VAT enablement process here? Has it started implementing the VAT in their business? A little bit of experience, if somebody can share about it. Anybody has started something? So ultimately, I really want to understand what you're going to take from this presentation back your business. So anybody has an idea about it? What do you really want to take from here? No one has an idea. Pretty good. That's good. So. Yeah, that's what I really want to understand. What do you want to take from here? This is very, very important questions. I really want to address this question because when you see attend any seminar or and you have attended various seminars from here, when people talk about these concepts, you really need to start applying these concepts into your business. Now again, when we go for the VAT enablement, we talk about impact assessment. Everybody talks about impact assessment. So how this impact has been assessed, how this impact has been determined. This impact is determined based on these concepts. We take these concepts, apply to individual transaction that you do within the business and try to determine, is it taxable? What is my place of supply? What is my time of supply? In order to determine, to come to a point, what is my cash flow impact in my business? Will the VAT applicable? Is it going to be, impacting my cash flow? Is it going to apply to all transactions or some of the transactions? Or do I need to have a very disclosure requirement? So these concepts is very, very important and it'll be useful if you try to relate them into your business. That's what the impact that you need to take it from here. What is the input tax recovery conditions are there? So we talk about a little bit place of supply, time of supply, reverse charge mechanism. But how do I claim the input VAT that I'm paying to my suppliers? In order to collect input VAT, a number of conditions must be satisfied before the supply, a recipient takes it. So one should be like, the person should be taxable person registered for the VAT. So a lot of people have, apprehensions that, the VAT is coming. Do I need to really register? My turnover is not that high. Although it's high, I'm trying to excuse my turnover and trying to escape from the registration. Do I really need to do so? If you're not registered for a business, if you're not registered for a VAT, you're going to lose this part. You're going to lose this input tax recovery, which means your supplies of the service or product becomes more costlier and less attractive as compared to the market who are registered business. So the VAT registration is healthier for the industry. If you're not registered, you're going to lose a lot of credit itself. So first of all, take the mind from that. If you register, you're going to lose. If you register, you're going to gain. Remember from here now. Second thing, the VAT on the purchase must have been correctly charged by the supplier. Now, since the VAT is coming, there'll be a lot of businesses which will not be subject to VAT because their turnover is so low, or maybe they are SME, they are starting. Will that mean that they'll not be able to raise invoice? Of course they'll be, because their turnover is not up to that stage, so they're not enable and eligible to register for a VAT. But you need to really understand that when somebody raising a tax invoice itself, the TRN number is used correct or not. That's your obligation to determine. So you need to understand that. Because somebody says that, you know, I am having a tax registration number TRN APX 105 and you pay him the VAT. Now, tomorrow you cannot go to FPA that, you know, I paid somebody in VAT and I need to claim it back. It's your prerogative that the VAT is charged correctly. The goods or service have been acquired for an eligible purpose. That's again becomes very, very important because there's a lot of practice that we do outside the business preview. So let me just give an example in relation to eligible purpose. Today I was with one of our client itself. He says to me, look, you know, so we're reviewing the transactions altogether. And he says, I do a transactions, I saw some license fee in his books. So I said, what this license fee is all about? He says, this is like, you know, somebody operate on my behalf. I'm surprised. How somebody can operate on your behalf, your license? That's illegal. So how do you deal with that particular transaction? He says, this is not a trade license. This is another license which I outsource somebody to use for purpose. So I said, do you have a proper documentation in relation to that? And does authority, the license that you're operating and given somebody, allows you to operate that? And he was under the, again, think pattern that is it really a legitimate transaction? So you need to go and talk about that. And now somebody's paying you and you are paying to authority itself in relation to that particular transaction, that is may or may not be eligible transaction for the VAT purpose, although somebody is collecting their tax registered, but it has to be in for eligible purpose. Recipient must receive and retain a tax invoice evidencing the transaction. So if you don't have a tax invoice, you cannot claim input VAT. The amount of VAT which the recipient seek to recover must have been paid in whole. So this is at the moment in the law. At the moment if you have paid, then only you can take input VAT. But it's not means that, you know, you cannot take input VAT credit before you settle down the things out there. It's have been settled down by somebody. That interpretation will gonna come in executive regulation, but that's gonna be the situation. In part, intended to pay, and whole in part. So this is our interpretation. So whether it's paid in part, intended to be paid, or whole in part, you can take input VAT credit. So it's not just only on paid. And certain incurred VAT is specifically blocked from being recoverable input tax, regardless of whether the above conditions have been met. There will be certain provisions are there in which you cannot take input VAT credit. Now, one of the example can be deemed supply. I'll explain that. Second slide. So input tax apportionment. So taking example of various businesses where you have a mixed supply. You have exempt supply as well as you have a taxable supply. Or within one of your company provide exempt supply, other companies within the group provides you know, taxable supply. But it's a group and you have various services built around it. How do you claim the input VAT in relation to that? Is it full value that I'm incurring in relation to, can I have a provision to allocate all my major expenses to the businesses which is taxable and don't do any charge about you know, exempt businesses? Do I have an option about that? How they will determine all the things about it? So what happens when there's a business which has a taxable mix or exempt supply, like such as mixed use building? You have a ground floor commercial, middle floor residential, third floor you have you know, freehold property which you already sold out. Now you're running maintenance service company coming and cleaning the entire building. So what will happen to that particular charge? How that input VAT credit I paid, let's say 50,000 to clean that building and I'm paying 2,500 as a VAT. So is it 2,500 is recoverable in full? So what happens in that case? There's a calculation. There's a calculation that need to be done to calculate the recoverable portion of the mixed input tax with reference to the ratio of input tax relating to taxable supply as to the total input tax incurred. So basically what I need to do in that case, I need to define what is my turnover, what is my value of supply pertaining to the taxable business only. Exempt business I cannot claim, but it doesn't mean that I cannot take the input VAT credit in relation to that particular transaction. I can take, but only in relation to the taxable supply. So what we expect, you know, what we're really expecting, you know, just a flavor about changes in the business. We'll be having a long-term contract. We have a lot of contracts and we're really worried about what will gonna happen to those contracts. When should I account for the VAT? Cash flow, when I'll get the payment. Really, it's gonna be a challenge. Transition rules and certification, has the work actually been completed? Documentations, unregistered subcontractors, input tax credit, how to apportion input tax on that. So there's a lot of apprehension, a lot of you know, ambiguity and within our mindset is there in relation to these particular topics. And we all need clarity on those. But the clarity on these aspects of things, a lot of provisions are already there. You know, a lot of people every day when I go to various forums and my clients, everybody asks that executive regulation is not there. Should I prepare for that? Now, what is you understand from implementing executive regulations? What it will gonna change? I remember back in when the federal tax agreement had been launched here in the UAE. People were saying, yeah, it's an FTA, it's been GCC wide agreement. When the law will come, we're gonna see about it. So it becomes like 4 months. When the procedure law came in, it's like, yeah, it's a procedure law, still we have time. The law has come. When the law has come, you did not find much of the changes from the FTA itself. The law is pretty much clear for the business. You are a business, you are providing any exempt supply, you may need to. That's a different story. You're providing a business into zero rated, the provisions are there. You're not into zero rated, the entire law is there for you. What the lack of clarity is there? So implementing regulations are for those industries where the clarification is not being provided, such as financial services, where the clarification is written that executive regulation should provide the clarity on that. When we talk about education and related services, healthcare and related services. Yeah, but then those related services, fine. I mean, once the exact regulation comes in, those will clarify. But that doesn't stop for us to prepare for the VAT. These things are already built in there. These definitions are pretty much there in the law. These are not awaiting from executive regulations, pretty much there. So I'm just trying to give a little bit flavor there as well. So deemed supply. Now, deemed supply, what this really means about a deemed supply? As we understand that when there's a supply, that's where the tax calculation happens. That's where I account for the tax. But will there be any scenario where I'm not making supply, but still I'm accountable for the VAT? Yes, they're going to be. And we understand that when there's a consideration, then only there's a tax is there. What if there is not consideration is there? Will that be a situation where the VAT is going to be applied? Yes, and that's where we call it deemed supply. Deemed supply is to curb the tax evasion. It's all about that, how to mitigate and limit the impact of tax evasion in the business. So you all have a business, we all running a business. And we all know that the indirect taxes are borne by the end consumer. So what if I'm just going to buy a car today and I'm buying Mercedes, which is the high-end car, G60, and it maybe comes 600,000 or 700,000. So I'm interested to buy that car. And when I buy the car, I'm gonna pay the VAT of that. You know, maybe 35,000, 40,000, or maybe I'm buying a much costlier car, I'm gonna pay VAT of 50,000. And that immediately becomes a lot of amount. So why shouldn't I do one thing? Why shouldn't I buy this car in the business? The business can take input VAT credit and I'll be get away with it. Should I buy a phone? Should I gift everybody a phone so that they need not to pay the VAT on those 4,000, so 200 dirhams you can save on an individual phone? It becomes a huge amount sometimes. Why should I give you know, the free things out there to the business? I receive certain things which is I'm taxable business, so I can take input bad credit. Where there's a exempt business, I provide the service free of charge to that company to avoid input bad credit. So likewise, there can be multiple scenarios which can be lead to tax evasion. To curb those tax evasion, the government comes with saying deemed supply. Now what is a deemed supply here? If you see here, the prizes, gifts, hampers given to an employee is fall within the bracket of deemed supply. Supply of goods for no consideration, such as free goods, unless sample or gift for a low value. Now, if you see here, this is where you need a little bit of clarification. What is a low value means? It may be $500, maybe 500 pounds, or 5,000 dirhams, 10,000 dirhams. This is a little bit of clarification. But that doesn't stop you from building your process to account for the deemed supply. It's only a threshold limit. My processes doesn't need to wait for executive regulation to change that. Free management services provided by holding company to subsidiary. Free services to related party. Employee use the company car for personal use. Business that is put to the non-economic activity, private purposes. So these are some of the examples, but likewise there are so many examples which happens, which we try to do that if we have a little bit of tax planning understanding. We try to definitely do a lot of situations there where we can avoid the tax. So government says that yes, you can try all the means, but we are going to catch you within the deemed supply concept. Whether you have consideration, no consideration, whether you're making supply or not making supply, if we can establish the relationship here, you're going to fall within that. And then, as a business, you're supposed to collect the 5% tax on that. So, will I going to raise an invoice to my employee? Will my ERP allows me to create an invoice to an employee? A lot of people have. Because invoice can only be created to a supplier. So how will I deal with the transaction in my system? Now, deemed supply not only mean that it will gonna be subject to a standard rate. That if we see other way around. If I'm not collecting, if I'm not charging the tax, what will happen? If I disallow the input VAT credit, that is also a form of tax payment. Isn't it that is? So either I disallow my input VAT credit that due on this particular product, or I charge output tax to an employee. That's considered a standard rated basically. So it falls within the definition. Either I don't take input VAT credit or I charge output VAT. Is considered deemed supply. Transition provision. Transition provision is something which we all need to really think about, and we need to be really serious about that, because obviously the when the tax coming in, it's not beginning of the new year for every business. It's not, we are not starting from scratch. The business is in existence and it'll gonna continue for a while. It'll gonna continue for a long, long time. But that means that there'll be certain transactions which is in place and which will continue while we are migrating from non-tax to tax regime. So what will happen to those transactions when I migrate from non-tax to tax? Well, am I supposed to pay the tax on that? Am I eligible to collect the tax from my employee via the contract? There's a lot of apprehensions about that. I'm doing a B2C service and B2B service. What will happen to those? A lot of our friends here in insurance business, they'll understand that what I'm trying to talk about. There's a lot of policies which they have issued in the last year for which, you know, the risk, they have collected the premium against the risk exposure itself. Now that has nothing to do with the VAT. VAT is coming, but my risk exposure in the last year has collected, I collected premium and the policy has been issued. And the customer is happy, insurance company is happy. But now VAT has come, so what should ideally be done now? Similarly, construction contracts are there. I have a lot of inventory built up, my building is half constructed, and I'm about to get my payment certificate. But that's not yet done. That may take maybe 2.5 months or 3 months to done, do altogether. I have completed a building, but there is a post-sales period itself, which I'm awaiting to clarify. That's where I'm gonna get my retention payment. I have a project that is just now started. I have received an advance payment for which the first billing will gonna happen in the next year. Likewise provisions. There's a lot of provisions like that. So what will happen to that? Transition rule for the contract. And fortunately, unfortunately, all of us might not have built in the tax clauses into our contract which can protect us from taking that forward. So a lot of contracts says that, you know, standard terms, it has no mention of tax. And not necessarily small SME business, big businesses, believe it or not. A lot of businesses in UAE, they conduct various activity which they are not even authorized to do that here. Now, so when they're going for registration purpose, that doesn't consider to be economic activity. That activity itself is not listed here. But they have a revenue against that. Unbelievable situation. So now, that need to be looked into. That's where business need to focus upon. So what happens when a contract is entered into prior to effective date of the VAT law which concern a supply, made wholly or partly after the effective date of VAT law, the VAT will be due on the supply taking place after the effective date of the tax law. Which means, I'll take a very small example. I made a payment for my health club this year. But my service ends, let's say my period, 1 year ends in September. So what will happen to that payment? That will be subject to VAT. But as an individual, am I liable to pay? Or a business is liable to collect? These two questions is very, very vital. Who is what? Who is going to do what? Now if you see principally, based on transition rules, the businesses are liable to collect the tax from me. Should they not able to do so, the value that they that pertains to the period in next year considered to be inclusive of VAT. Which means immediately my 5% is going to lose. Some of the business have only 5% margin. So what is going to happen? My entire margin going to erode away if the customer doesn't pay. So then they have a provision. Now that provision is going to be there. So as a business, if a contract is expanding and prolonging in Jan 2018 and year 2018, you're supposed to collect the tax, whether it's B or C, whether it's B2B or B2C. Should you not able to do so, you have to account for a VAT. And you have a provision that should you are not able to recover the VAT on that particular part, you can claim as bad debt, that I am unable to collect that. So if somebody is not paying you VAT, you still have a provision about the bad debt. So the door is not open. The FDA is not, the government is not ignoring the aspect that, you know, there will be complications, there will be issues, and people may or may not pay the issues itself. So in harmony of that, they have various provisions built in to protect the community of the business. You have various options. Although it may take a little bit teething issues, but they have the provision. And tax, whenever the law comes in, it try to consider and address all the aspect of things. So in this scenario, if you see here, the contract sell to company B for 5,000, contract is silent on the VAT. So the must account for VAT 5% for the FTA value is 217. That's considered to be inclusive of VAT. Another one. However, a company B is registered for a business and entitled to full VAT recovery on the cost incurred, company A can treat the contract as if price stated was exclusive VAT and able to charge VAT in company B in addition. What does it mean? You know, there may be certain businesses which are not registered. They will be always hesitant and they will always give you the condition of the contract that tax is not mentioned here. A lot of government client also will going to do that. That I'm not liable to pay the tax. You deal with the tax your way. It's not included in the tax and the price is inclusive of VAT. You deal with it. Now in that cases, you can say that, you know, I'm not inclusive of VAT. You can claim refund. But if a business is genuinely registered, he should not refuse to pay the VAT. It's only the cash flow things that you probably need to think of. But eventually what you...
So what I'm trying to say is that, in this case, the businesses should not worry about that I'm supposed to pay the VAT, whether I'll be able to recover that VAT or not. Because if you're a registered business, you're going to get input VAT credit against whatever you're going to pay. So that should not be a problem. Transition rule for early invoicing and payment. So no matter whatever trick you try to apply, the FTA has provision to deal with those things. So if the transfer of goods under the supplier supervision happening, the goods are placed in possession of the recipient of the goods, completion of assembly of the goods, a customer statement is issued, the customer accept and supply of the goods. So basically we'll try to think about various scenarios where I treat something as an import, I try to route the service from various countries and then I'll avoid the VAT under the reverse charge mechanism. I'm not supposed to pay the VAT in that case because it's going to be reverse charge. So they have put together all the provisions in here to avoid those early invoicing and payment. So That's it from my side. Do you pay any tax? There is no point of input VAT credit. Now, when you start selling the goods, the cycle begins from the 1st Jan 2018. When you start selling the goods, you will be the first person who will going to start collecting the tax. And the cycle goes on until unless the goods reach to the final consumer. So you will collect the VAT on the goods that you sell, which you have already in your possession, and pay to the FTA based on your cycle. It's a monetary transaction. It's a guarantee that I'm given.
See, you have said, Mr. Nirav, you said that this price should be advertised inclusive of VAT. In a retail trade, when you know the prices are written, MRP or RRP is written. So, say 100 dirham is today, 1st January onwards, but you have to write 110 or 105, or you have to be 100 and then you work back to 95 and 94 something and then 5.
So, either you mention on your price list very, very clearly, this is 100 plus 5% VAT to be charged.
Okay.
Or you mention 105. Whatever price that you mention, if you do not disclose anything, it will be deemed to be inclusive of taxes.
Okay, but if you write exclusive of VAT, 100 exclusive of VAT,
then,
that's fine.
Then you said you plus this. So you need to clearly mention this. That's the idea.
So there's no regulation, there's no compulsion of putting on one particular thing, inclusive price.
It's up to you, how do you want to put it?
No, there is no regulation or law.
So it's up to you whether you want to, if you do not mention, it is deemed to be inclusive of tax.
That okay. And add and then give it to you. No. Whatever the price displays on the product tag is considered to be inclusive of VAT. So it's your responsibility to show the price is inclusive of VAT. So today if your price of the product is 100, price should tag should say 105.
Sure.
Yes, 100% sure.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a question. I had actually a couple of questions, but then I heard of a couple of the answers, but it was not satisfactory for me. Now I'm like in a dilemma, I'm totally confused. So I put across a situation. I'm a manufacturer, I'm importing components from India, from our own group company, okay? We are importing here, we are getting it assembled or manufacturing the product here using the imported components plus the already existing our stock items, which is again in component format. Then we manufacture that and given into one of our group company who is running retail business. And a couple of them giving into distribution and the balance going into export to GCC to other group companies. Okay, the scenario is like this. Every group company is connected, but the different shareholders. Shareholding pattern is different. And there is an online company who sells this as well. And then one of the companies constructing its own property and supplying there. All the situation, how the holding company is responsible for it? Tax will incur and how we can do. And the scenario goes back.
So wait a minute. Yeah. First of all, you'll have to start dividing each question and address it separately.
So, all right, okay. So the component import, it's not covered with the VAT, right? We don't have to.
Let's not go into that. First of all, you only mentioned that each one has a different shareholding.
Yeah, but it's under one holding group.
No, if it has a different shareholding, how it is under one holding company? One is, on one hand, he is saying that there is different shareholding and then he is saying there is a common holding company.
Yes.
So that...
X is one shareholder in all the companies. But the rest shares are different.
Yeah, but if you only hold 1% shareholding, you are not a holding company.
No, the holding company holds...
So, clarifying that now. So, No. So, if you have a majority share, okay, then your internal transaction within the group may not be subjected to VAT. However, leave that aside for the moment.
Okay.
When you are importing, you have a reverse charge mechanism. You are paying input tax credit on that. When you are buying locally, you have a local VAT which you pay.
But for manufacturing, how it differs?
Whichever. So whatever you are buying, you pay, whether it is for manufacturing, for anything else. It's not your import duty you are paying.
Yeah.
So please do not confuse it with import duty.
But it is getting manufactured.
Please do not confuse it with import duty. You may be exempt from import duty. You may not be exempt for VAT.
Yeah.
Unless you are in the exempt category. So let's not confuse the two. Right? So the even if you are buying raw material locally, you are paying VAT on that. Hmm. All that you are entitled to is to set it off against your output credit.
Yeah, but the situation I told is using that VAT paid or not paid exempted material with an old stock, and then you're creating a new product.
So that's fine.
Then you're selling.
So that's fine. In the manufacturer is supposed to create his own product. Yeah. So it's not going to match raw material and this and that. No.
So you, the tax return, how will claim?
Yes, so that's why we are saying that you are entitled to get input tax credit.
Okay.
So it's all different transaction which you need to apply differently. Yes, sir.
I have a question. We are in the leasing of real estate, commercial as well as residential properties. Now, commercial properties, hotels or the commercial towers under construction. One is that, are we able to claim the benefit of VAT which is payable or being paid or going to be paid to the contractors immediately, or it is going to be after completion of the property?
No, so in any construction contract, you will have to match it, the revenue and expenses. You can't, you will incur in 3-year period. You'll start selling only after 2 or 3 years of your construction period. So you need to start matching it. If you have progress invoice or your sale and you start recovering some money in advance, you can start matching it and claim it against that.
So it's
because it's commercial, it's taxable fully.
Right.
So you get credit throughout.
Right.
There's no lapse. It's only the time which is going to be different.
No, I'm saying that from the existing commercial properties, we'll be collecting the VAT while we'll be doing the leasing.
Yeah.
And the property which is under construction on which we'll be paying the VAT.
So don't mix the two transactions.
Can we not claim an offset?
If it is within the same entity, you may be able to.
Yes.
But there are two different transactions.
That's right.
Okay, so you treat the transactions independently and then look at it at an entity level.
And it's within the same entity.
So then, again, we need to look at it in more detail.
So actually, okay. in your case, what will happen, as if I can correctly, you have some commercial property on which you're collecting the VAT, input VAT is there, and you're trying to pay the VAT on the capital which is under construction, WIP stage itself. Now, in WIP stage, there is a two aspect is there. Does your asset, now that we need to really little bit wait about exacting regulation, I should say that whether your asset that you're constructing will fall within the capital recovery scheme. Yes.
Then there is a capital asset scheme.
Capital assets. That is going to come in.
If it is going to fall in that,
then you can set off immediately.
Okay.
You can take, like, you know, whatever the input VAT that you have, you can set off against output VAT and you pay net to the government. But if it falls within the capital group scheme, then there's a slabs, the based on the useful life of the asset itself. Then there's a slab on the capital.
And second question is on the residential property. So if it takes, say, about 3 years of construction, so you pay the VAT to the contractors, you create the reserve in the books, and then you claim after 3 years when you start the leasing?
No, that's what I'm saying, that again, we'll have to look at one, your accounting treatment. Second, your sale conditions. If you started selling under construction and collected certain money, your VAT, output VAT also occurs along
with selling, on leasing.
I'm giving you an example. So when you sell, so what he is asking is, if I'm incurring in year one and I'm not selling, when do I claim? Is what his question is. So I have to see what kind of contracts he has, whether he is selling during the construction phase, whether he is collecting some money during that period. Are you matching revenue and... When you start recognizing revenue, that's when you have to start matching and claim credit. Majority shareholding, which is
right.
Common.
Right.
And you have common control,
then you can go for a group. If you are minority, then you will have. The second issue is that if...
Let him.
Sorry, go ahead.
It's not just only the share. I have 50% voting rights. Okay. Or third, I have a control by any other means.
That will decide.
Fourth, if together with other entities, I also manage by a third entity, I can group. Which means, shareholding is not the only decision criteria.
I understand.
Like in UAE, last time I also, when I was talking about registration, I covered that aspect. Yeah. That you need to establish the control. If your constitutional documents are able to establish that control criteria, yes, you can formulate the group.
In DIFC, is there clarity on that, on the VAT? Wealth management companies operating out of DIFC.
Now, DFC basically those falls within the category of the financial services.
Right.
Now, so when it fall within the financial services, executive regulation should say that's a clear-cut word on that. But DIFC is not considered to be a designated zone. It's a mainland entity altogether. It's nothing. So if it falls within the designated zone, yes, those may fall outside. But if the DIFC is not considered to be a designated zone, it's considered to be mainland entity. And then...
And we are extremely grateful to our speakers, Mr. Nirav and Mr. Anurag, for being with us and taking your time. And I thank all of you being here with us tonight. And I would also like to thank our sponsors, who without them, which has not been possible, the sessions, our platinum sponsors, Danube, NMC, UAE Exchange, Nikkei, TASE, Bank of Baroda, IFCA. And also IFCA and all our media partners, including Gulf News. Thank you so much. I really appreciate. Have a wonderful evening. The dinner is open. And any more questions, they're all here. You can personally ask them. Thank you.
It's the second session conducted by the IBPC on the VAT subject. And compared to the first one, there's a basic one, but this is into the more detailed one regarding the place of goods and supplies. And the session was very informative. And hopefully everyone has get the more knowledge and the more information about the VAT. And now as the people are more curious about the things, so with this session, they have the answer for their queries. And I would like to thank the IBPC for organizing the session on the VAT, and hope two more sessions is going to be happen. So I would like to again thank the IBPC for their support to their members and their community. Thank you very much.
It was a fantastic session, and you know, idea shared was very interactive, and you know, both the speakers was given a good light in a lot of confusions what we had in the business fraternity, and I believe BPC is doing a great job to support the fraternity and the Indian professional business people over here to have the right feedback and right insights about the VAT implementation. And all the best. And
at the outset, the initiative of IBPC to conduct a series of workshops or seminars for improving the awareness of its members is commendable. I'm very pleased with the sessions, and we are looking forward to the further three or four sessions before we can draw some conclusive understanding for this. As far as VAT is concerned, it's going to transform the landscape of UAE's business, and all the business houses today is incidentally very busy trying to recruit a VAT manager and probably also a legal manager. The only drawback I could see today is that the presenters need to go more deep and be practical and try to take more practical examples so that the viewers can understand what are they intended by each of their slides or the laws. And some are able to do, and some may need a little more improvement. But over the period of time, I'm sure this will help all of us, the IBPC members. Good luck, IBPC. And overall, there is no need for any pessimism on VAT, because at the end of the day, the country's economy is a lot dependent on non-oil revenues, and the GDP needs a lot of boost for pumping money into the infrastructure, healthcare, education, and the Vision 2030 of Dubai, and the Industrial Vision 2025 of Abu Dhabi, etc. So VAT is for good, and let's all wait and watch for a good economy and the positiveness of VAT.
It's a great initiative by IBPC for starting this VAT session. I was not there for the first session, but I attended this second session. It was quite informative. We got a lot of information, what way in which we have to pay the VAT, and how the VAT is applicable for the businesses in the UAE. So it was quite informative, and we really, really enjoyed the session. So thanks to IBPC for organizing such a knowledge sharing seminars. Thank you very much.
We are actually happy to be today in the VAT, the convention, the day two. And we see this will be an eye-opener for the entire IBPC community, not only us, also all the traders as well, all the business people. And we as a logistic and shipping company in Dubai we also have to gain a lot from this the complete session, and we learned the how to register, how to get the benefit of the VAT, how to collect the VAT and pass on to the government. This would be our the focus for the rest of the VAT regime. So far we had no issue of the VAT or taxation here, but however this is going to be the eye-opener for all of us, and we as a logistic company is taking a very strong step to ensure all our transactions, all our the customs and the import clearances and the freight forwarding activities done in a proper way, so that VAT could be collected and passed on to the FTA in time. Thank you very much.
Hello, good evening. My name is Mr. S.K. Joshi. I work in a construction firm as the CEO. I was very much delighted to attend this evening seminar. It's been very informative, and it seems that I did miss the first one, which I could not, but now knowing that there are more coming up, I believe I must attend those three to complete my full experience and information to make myself up to date. I thank IBPC management to have organized this. Thank you very much.